First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 6. Listen carefully and answer questions 1 to 6.
Hello, welcome to the Travel Depot. How can I help you?
Well, I'm looking for a reasonably priced holiday. I went to South Africa for a month last year, and I'd like to see North America this time, maybe Canada. But I'm also interested in Europe if the prices to Canada are too expensive. I'm on quite a tight budget, you see.
Well, you could go to Europe, but I'll get some prices for Canada first. I've been to Vancouver. It's lovely at this time of year. And we have some special offers on at the moment.
Okay, well, I have some relatives over in Vancouver, so that would be good. I can always travel around Europe next year. Besides, it may be a bit too hot for me at this time.
Right, let's have a look at some prices then. When would you like to go?
Sometime at the end of next month if possible, but I'm quite flexible any time between the 24th and the 31st. I'd like to go for 3 weeks.
Well, there's lots of availability for those dates. Now, if you're concerned about the cost, it's cheaper if you don't mind not flying direct.
Sorry, what do you mean?
Well, if you don't mind changing planes, then it's cheaper.
Oh, well, I don't mind changing planes.
In that case, the cheapest flight I have leaves on the 25th and changes in New York. It's only a short stop. You'll be in the airport for 2.5 hours. How does that sound?
Sounds good, but what's the price?
That's £412 for a return flight, but that doesn't include airport tax. Would you like to arrange any accommodation?
No, I have a cousin I can stay with. All I need is the flight, so I think I'll take that one.
Right, I'll just check availability for your return. 3 weeks, did you say?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, well, there are seats available on the 14th or the 15th. Which one would you prefer?
The 14th sounds good. Yes, from the 25th to the 14th sounds fine.
I'll reserve that for you then. Can you tell me your name, please?
Jim Jackson.
Is that J-A-C-K-S-O-N?
That's right.
And can I take an address and contact number?
Yes, it's 10 Allen Road, Oldham. Do you want a home number or my mobile?
Either's fine.
Well, my home number is 0151 433 398.
Okay, so you're booked on flight number VN217 to Vancouver, leaving London Heathrow at 11:35 in the morning on the 25th and returning on the 14th. So that's 20 nights. Now, one more thing.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 7 to 10. Now listen and answer questions 7 to 10.
Now, one more thing. Do you have any travel insurance? We recommend all our clients take out some kind of cover, even though most people don't end up needing it. Most people have it just for peace of mind.
Well, what type of cover do you have?
There are two choices, the Gold Star and the Silver Star. Our most comprehensive cover is the Gold Star, which will cost £21 for the period you are away. It's a good policy because it covers almost all eventualities, even extreme sports such as snowboarding and skydiving.
What about the Silver Star?
That's £18, but it doesn't cover you for any dangerous sports.
Well, for £3, I think I'll take the first one. The gold cover, please.
Right, and is there anything else I can help you with?
Well, do you have any information about what to do in Vancouver?
Yes, I'm sure there's something on the computer that can help. Yes. There's a Shakespeare play at the theatre, but at $54 it's quite expensive. That starts at 8 p.m. The City Museum is really popular too, if you like that kind of thing. They have a special exhibition of Japanese armour next month. Entrance is free and the museum is open from 9 to 4:30, Monday to Saturday. Would you be interested in either of those?
Oh, well, maybe.
Well, I'm sure you can arrange that when you get there anyway. So it's the flight and the Gold Star insurance. That's £433 in total.
Can I pay by Visa?
Yes, of course. If you start...
That is the end of part one.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turns to part two.
Part two.
You will hear two university students talking about a music course.
First, look at questions 11 to 13. As you listen to the first part of the interview, answer questions 11 to 13.
Josie, come in. How are you?
I'm good.
Can I get you a coffee or anything?
No, that's okay. I can't stay long, but you said you wanted to talk to me about that course I'm doing this semester, Music 103?
That's right. Actually, I was a bit confused because I thought you were majoring in maths.
That's right, I am. I'm doing 4 maths modules this year. But it's an optional course. You just choose it if you're interested. And you can do it whatever department you're in. Why? Are you thinking about doing it?
Well, I'm not sure. What are the requirements?
What?
The course requirements. I mean, what do I need to know about music to be accepted on it? I do listen to a lot of music. Everything from hip-hop and rap to classical. And I can sing, sort of.
Well, for a start, one special thing about this course is that it's distance learning. You don't actually have to be at the university to do it, and you don't have lectures. So you've got to be able to work on your own without someone telling you what to do all the time.
Oh? Oh. No, that should be okay, I reckon. I'm more worried about the actual musical stuff, like... I don't know how to read music.
That doesn't matter. They don't assume that. You'll learn as you go along. How's your maths?
Not too bad.
Right. Some of it's quite mathematical, so you really need to be strong there.
But you play the violin, don't you? I don't play anything.
You don't need to. What about computer skills? You're okay there?
Yes, reasonably. Does that matter?
Yes, I'd say they're essential. Like I said, it's all distance learning, so it's computer-based.
Now look at questions 14 to 20.
But what about lectures?
You don't attend any. It's all online. So lots of the students aren't here in Canada at all. They're studying from home all over the world. We've got someone from my group in Jamaica and a couple from Taiwan. Oh, and some from Hong Kong as well.
So how does it work?
Oh, well, there's a multimedia course website on the internet where you can listen. You can listen and watch at the same time. And, of course, you can do it at your own pace. So if you don't understand something, you just go back. Or if you want some more examples of the music, there are links there to things that you can listen to. There's quite a lot of theory, but it's all done through musical examples, so it's practical at the same time. Like in the last module I did, we looked at a bit of the music from the movie Star Wars. The Darth Vader theme, you know.
Dum, 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 dum.
Yeah. Then we looked at a theme from Wagner's Tristan and Isolde. Do you know it? Written in the 1850s. And we could see there were all sorts of parallels between them. And that's a feature of the course. We often look at modern Hollywood themes to illustrate concepts in classical music.
Hmm. It sounds really interesting. Do you have a course book?
No, we don't use one. We're given a software program called Notability Light. And what it does is it presents what we write, the music we write, really clearly. And it also allows us to play back any piece of music on our computer at home. But that's not all. We can write our own music, quite complex stuff for various instruments, and the program plays it back to us.
Plays the actual music?
Yes. So it means that your computer is actually your own musical instrument. And we can even submit our finished pieces to our tutor by email.
So you do need your own computer, obviously.
Yes, with at least 64 megabytes of RAM.
That's okay. I've got 128.
Hmm. Oh, and a CD-ROM and a sound card, of course.
No problem. So, how long is the course?
It's 6 months. There are two a year, so you could actually enroll for the next one if you wanted. It starts in January. I started last September, and I finish in February.
And how many credits is it?
3. In order to pass, you've got to do 6 assignments. I'm just doing my 4th one now. And take a final examination. Oh, anyway, why don't you call around sometime and I'll show you the sort of things we do. You can even listen to some of my music.
That would be great. Well, thanks, Josie. Now, are you sure you don't have time for that coffee?
That is the end of part 2.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turns to part 3.
Part 3.
You will hear a talk on ocean spills. As you listen to the talk, circle the appropriate letter for questions 21 to 23.
First, look at questions 21 to 23. As you listen, answer the questions.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I'll talk about unusual ocean spills that have occurred in the world's oceans. In November of 1992, people at beaches in Canada and Alaska noticed something strange. Blue turtles, red beavers, green frogs, and yellow ducks came bobbing toward them. They soon found out where the strange creatures were coming from. A ship from Hong Kong was on its way to Tacoma, Washington, when it was hit by a severe storm in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. During the storm, huge waves washed 12 containers overboard. Inside the containers were 29,000 plastic bath toys. One of the containers opened, and thousands of plastic bath toys spilled out and began to float across the Pacific Ocean. 10 months later, the first yellow ducks arrived on the North American shore. Beachcombers along the shore began to find the toys and reported them to local newspapers. But the people who were most excited by the plastic toys were the oceanographers. It gave them an opportunity to study ocean currents and winds.
Before the conversation continues, look at questions 24 to 30. Now listen to the second part of the discussion.
Oceanographers drop bottles into the ocean to study these things. But it would be too expensive to drop 29,000 bottles into the ocean at once. Imagine the value of studying the plastic ducks and frogs. This gave some interesting information to the oceanographers. The first toys were picked up in Sitka, Alaska, 10 months after they were washed off the ship. Some headed back into the North Pacific, while others drifted around the Arctic Ocean and headed for the North Atlantic. Many of the toys were swept northeast by the wind and were frozen in the ice of the Bering Sea. They're expected to cross the North Pole and float on down to the British Isles. This reminds me of another unusual ocean spill. In 1990, a ship travelling to the west coast of the United States from Korea was caught in a severe storm. The waves swept 21 containers of Nike shoes into the water. Scientists estimate that about 80,000 running, jogging and hiking shoes, 40,000 pairs of shoes to you and me, hit the water at once. The shoes were for men, women and children. About 6 months later, people at beaches from Oregon to British Columbia began to find running shoes washed ashore. By the end of the year, Washington newspapers reported people finding hundreds of shoes. In Seattle, thousands of shoes floated to shore. Since the shoes were not attached, they arrived one at a time. The shoes were dirty, but after they were washed, they were still in good condition. People set up exchanges to find matches for their shoes. Oceanographers studied the information to learn more about the ocean. Some Nike shoes reached Hawaii. Others went to the Philippines and Japan. According to the scientists, some of the shoes are on a trip around the world and should end up back in Washington and Oregon. Can you believe it? Many pairs of running shoes, as well as plastic ducks and frogs, are still on their ocean journey. So if you go to a beach anywhere in the world, don't be surprised if you see a green plastic frog or a woman's size 7 jogging shoe bobbing toward you. So keep your eyes out so you may find free bath toys and even a new pair of shoes. Thank you for attending my lecture.
That is the end of part 3.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turns to part 4.
Part 4.
You will hear an environmental studies student giving a presentation about his project on saving an endangered species of plant. Now you have some time to look at questions 31 to 40. Now listen and answer questions 31 to 40.
For my presentation, I'm going to summarise what I've found out about efforts to save one plant species, the juniper bush. It once flourished in Britain and throughout the world's temperate zones, but over the last few decades has declined considerably. Before I go on to explain the steps being taken to save it in England, let me start by looking at some background information and why the juniper has been so important in cultural as well as ecological terms, historically and in the present day. Firstly, I want to emphasise the fact that juniper is a very ancient plant. It has been discovered that it was actually amongst the first species of plants to establish itself in Britain in the period following the most recent Ice Age. And, as I say, it has a much valued place in British culture. It was used widely as a fuel during the Middle Ages because when burnt, the smoke given off is all but invisible, and so any illicit activities involving fire could go on without being detected. For example, cooking game hunted illegally. It also has valuable medicinal properties. Particularly during large epidemics, oils were extracted from the juniper wood and sprayed in the air to try to prevent the spread of infection in hospital wards. And these days, perhaps its most well-known use is in cuisine, cooking, where its berries are a much valued ingredient, used to flavour a variety of meat dishes and also drinks. Turning now to ecological issues, juniper bushes play an important role in supporting other living things. If juniper bushes are wiped out, this would radically affect many different insect and also fungus species. We simply cannot afford to let this species die out. So, why is the juniper plant declining at such a rapid rate? Well, a survey conducted in the north and west of Britain in 2004-5 showed that a major problem is the fact that in present-day populations, ratios between the sexes are unbalanced, and without a proper mix of male and female, bushes don't get pollinated. Also, the survey found that in a lot of these populations, the plants are the same age, so this means that bushes grow old and start to die at similar times, leading to swift extinction of whole populations. Now, the charity Plant Life is trying to do something to halt the decline in juniper species. It's currently trying out two new major salvage techniques, this time focusing on lowland regions of England. The first thing it's trying is to provide shelters for the seedlings in areas where juniper populations are fairly well established. These, of course, are designed to help protect the plants at their most vulnerable stage. A further measure is that in areas where colonies have all but died out, numbers are being bolstered by the planting of cuttings which have been taken from healthy bushes elsewhere. Now, I hope I've given a clear picture of the problems facing this culturally and ecologically valuable plant, and of the measures being taken by Plant Life to tackle them. If anyone has any questions, I'd be happy.
That is the end of part 4.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.